His name was known all over the world, especially by the millions of children who read and loved his books, but he never forgot his Liverpool roots. I'm talking about Brian Jakes, author of the Redwall series of books, who sadly died earlier this month. Simon O'Brien has been looking back at the life of this extraordinary man and the city and people who had such a profound influence on him.
Old stories told by travellers, great songs that bards have sung, of mossflower summers faded gone, when Redwall stones were young.
I never wrote it for publication. I wrote it as a story to read to the children at the school. A mouse is the child, and the child is trying to resolve something, to be better, to be a warrior, to be a hero. And if the little mouse can, well, why can't the child?
The charm is in the characters. They're all animals. There's no humans in them at all. The baddies are the rats, you know, and the stoats, and the little happy things, the little dibbins, he called them, are little mice.
Brian Jakes is a literary giant. His fame spread far beyond Liverpool's shores because of his Redwall books, which have sold more than 20 million copies worldwide and been translated into 28 different languages. And yet he could walk around his home city of Liverpool largely unnoticed, people unaware of his stardom overseas. Brian's writing skills shone through at an early age, but as Brian told me when we met in 2006, it got him into trouble at school.
I wrote about the little bird who cleans the crocodile's teeth. You see, because I'd seen it in a film, a short documentary film. And I wrote this, and we were getting on with something else, and he has a look, you know, he was one of them, really. Where did you copy this, Mr. Jakes? And I said, I never copied it, sir. And he said, how old are you? And I said, 10, sir. He said, well, let me tell you something. Boys of 10 cannot write like this. Now, you tell me where you copy this, or I shall cane you. And I wouldn't back down, he caned me in the end. And I realised I was a writer.
The son of Irish Catholic immigrants, Brian spent much of his youth hanging out down here by the riverside. And it must have had a very profound effect on him. Because even though he'd inherited a love of books from his father, at age 15, he turned his back on academia, left school, and joined the Merchant Navy to set sail from the mouth of the Mersey to see the world.
The drizzle on the cobbles in the early morning, that's my Liverpool.
We're happy. But the call of Liverpool drew him back home, where Brian did every job under the sun.
I was a policeman, I was a docker, I was, you know, long-distance lorry driver. Been round the block 10 times, Simon, you know, anything to make a crust.
My Liverpool's a town of dogs and kids all kicking up in the streets.
In the 60s, he and his brothers Jimmy and Tony formed the Liverpool Fishermen, a folk band that toured the pubs and clubs of Liverpool.
He was a folk singer as well as me, did the clubs with his three brothers, as the Fishermen they were called, rowdy, you know, all join in type single. And they were good, they were great. But Brian's monologues and poetry stole the night, because he was always good with words, always good with words.
And I used to come here every morning.
His foray into children's writing happened quite by chance. Whilst delivering milk to the Royal School of the Blind, he would read books to the children.
Now, some of the stuff, especially for the older kids, that the publishers used to send in, I didn't like the stuff I was reading, you know what I mean? It was about the now, about the here, today, you know, divorce problems with the family and teenage angst, and, and I thought, oh, hey.
Surely there must be a bit more imagination to be had in this.
Yeah, what happened to the magic?
Disappointed at what he was reading for the children, Brian decided to have a go at writing his own book.
Once upon a time.
However, it was a friend, Alan Durban, who later persuaded him to get it published.
I said, it's only a kid's thing, Alan. I said, you don't have to waste your valuable time reading it, you know. So he said, no, give me it here. Now, he took it away and he read it. And he sent it to his publishers with an advice note saying, this is one of the best children's stories I've ever read. You'd be foolish not to publish it.
25 years and 39 books later, Brian Jakes is now one of the best-selling children's writers in the world.
Seated in the branches of the elm tree at the north wall of the abbey, Clooney watched the shadows lengthen. To the west, the sky was crimson with sunset. Soon he would raise the plank to the parapet. then let them beware. No tinpot order of mice was going to stand against the might of Clooney the Scourge.
In America, Brian Jake's Red Wall books are bestsellers and his book tours were always sold out. His death was front page news there.
There has been major press coverage, the Washington Post, the New York Times, Entertainment Weekly, and there seems to be a personal slant with each of these tributes. It's talking about how Brian, these writers know that Brian has touched lives. It's not a cold, detached obituary, it's how Brian and Redwall affected these writers' lives.
Children from all over the world and from all walks of life have been drawn to his novels, including The Rich and Famous.
I had to go to number 10 Downing Street and see Tony and Cherie. Actually, they were charming.
The librarian recommended them for my eldest son, who's very imaginative, loved reading, as a good read. And so as a family, we started to get hooked. Then, of course, I moved to Downing Street. And in the course of that, who should turn up one day, who should I meet, but Brian Jakes. And I said to him, of course I know Redwall. Absolutely, we read them.
To many people in Liverpool, Brian will be best remembered for his eclectic radio programme, Jake's Town, which aired for 20 years on Radio Merseyside.
Hiya, Tingy. Jake's here. So, you can sit back for the next hour. Put your feet up and have a cup of tea. Go ahead. Muck in. You're at your ninnies.
I've never, ever heard a programme like it since. He played opera, he loved opera, he absolutely adored opera. But what was lovely about it was that, first I think they introduced people to opera who would never otherwise have listened, because you don't normally get that on a local radio station or any station. But the way he talked about these arias that he played, I mean, he loved them. And the joy he got out of them was really so beautifully expressed, but not in a Radio 3 voice or in a Classic FM voice, but in Jakes's voice, Scouse.
He knew his audience. You know, and that's what you need to know. If you're presenting a show, you've got to know the audience who will listen. And Jake, you knew his audience. You know how to tickle that laughter bud, and you know how to tease that nostalgia germ. And he used to be able to evoke that emotional germ as well. He was a very gifted person, and it wasn't through learning, it was something he had in him.
On the day we met, Brian took me to Stanley Park, the place which inspired the setting for the Redwall Adventures.
I used to wander up here, and of course there's all flower beds and everything. And these walls, the red sandstone of Liverpool,
yeah.
What is over that wall? Well, you're a little kid and you can't see over.
What's the enchanted land over there?
That's right, I didn't know it was just Liverpool's grounds, you know.
My tale of dusty far-off times, when warrior hearts were true, then stories.
His books have been transferred to audio CD so that blind children all over the world can now listen to the stories, accompanied by the music of Billy Marr.
Those were the days.
You can hear as he's narrating there, there's a real poetry to his voice. Is that what he was, a poet?
That's right. And it's a Scouse voice, but it could travel the world, you know. The Americans love that sort of accent.
What was it about him, do you think? What was it that made him so unique that he could turn his hand to anything and write such successful stories?
He was so good at it, that's why. He knew exactly how to put the words together. He was a great wordsmith, that's what it was. That conveyed the atmosphere, and so once he had your attention, he put the humour in there and the pathos. I went to his funeral. This is his order of service. Look at how good he is with words. His little intro. So here is my story, may it bring some smiles and a tear or so. It happened once upon a time, far away and long ago. Outside the night wind keens and wails, come listen to me, the teller of tales. You know, you go like that, the teller of tales.
Here we go, tell me your tale.
That's right, yeah, yeah. And kids love that sort of thing, because he was great with kids.
It's been 5 years since I strolled through Stanley Park with Brian Jakes to discuss how the lovely warm sandstone here had been his inspiration for his incredibly successful Redwall series. And meeting him that day, there were just a few things that really struck me about this man. First of all, his absolute command of the English language, his wit, but most of all, I think it was his warmth. This was a completely warm human being. And I think that's what I love about the story of Brian Jakes, is the fact that by doing something incredibly warm, by giving blind children the love of literature, it turned him into an international superstar, one of the greatest literary exports this country has ever known.